thinking that's outside the box. Your host, Jeff Nyquist.
To the ones that wear the uniforms, to the ones that lost their lives, to a nation that's been torn, God hears your painful cries. I will stand with you, my friend, for justice will amend. America, America.
I'm Jeff Nyquist, and tonight I have a very special program. I am conducting an interview with Viktor Kalashnikov and Marina Kalashnikov in Moscow. They are Russian journalists. Viktor Kalashnikov worked as a lieutenant colonel in the KGB. He also worked for the presidential administration of Boris Yeltsin. What's important about the Kalashnikovs is coming from inside the Soviet and Russian power structure, they confirm many of the things I've been trying to warn Americans about for the past 10 years. These things include the fact that the changes in Russia were compromised by the KGB, that the changes were not what they appeared to be, that Russian democracy was taken over by the KGB and used for purposes of deception and for modernization of the system of police state control in Russia, that Russia is militarizing and preparing for a future war against the United States, whereas Marina Kalashnikov has told me a number of small wars leading to a larger war with the United States. Of course, Russia does not want to immediately challenge the United States. It does not want to attack the United States while NATO still exists, while Europe would be embroiled in war. Russia would like to dominate Europe without a war in Europe. Russia would like to dominate Europe with a number of smaller wars and events and catastrophes that could overwhelm the United States and negate it as a world power, leaving the United States in a position where it is so weak that China and Russia together could dismember it and finish it off. The important thing about the threat from Russia is to understand the dynamic, the economic dynamic that is underway. It has long been said by Marxists, and especially Marxist-Leninists, that eventually the United States and the West, the capitalist world, will suffer a severe economic crisis. This is the crisis of capitalism that the Marxists have always waited for. The crisis foretold heralds the onset of the great world revolution, in which communism takes over the entire world and capitalism is put down forever. It was Khrushchev who said that there will never be peace as long as there are any capitalists left in the West. They must all be eradicated. What we have in Russia is not a new democracy, a new capitalism ruled by capitalist oligarchs. What we have is a new kind of police state, guided at the top by people who are still following the old Soviet plan, which is to destroy capitalism, destroy the West, and destroy America. So it's very important to understand that this plan, which was described by KGB defector Anatoly Golitsyn in his 1984 book New Lies for Old, also involved the controlled collapse of communism, the apparent elimination of the police state, but all along the police state would remain in control. What you're going to hear from the Kalashnikovs tonight is that Russia basically is still under the old Soviet elite. It is still on a collision course with the United States. It is still hostile to the U.S. and determined to prevail in an ongoing Cold War. This is very important for Americans to understand because Americans are very naive about Russia. They think Russia is somehow their ally in the war on terror. But in reality, Russia is the origin point of modern global terrorism. It is the KGB that fostered, created, and educated a whole generation of terrorists in the Third World and in the Muslim world. It is the KGB that has brought about the current situation in the world in which so many Third World countries are at odds with the United States. It is Russia that is supporting Iran in creating its nuclear arsenal, supporting North Korea in its ambitions, supporting China in the creation of a blue water navy and a modern missile force. It is Russia which is animating all of America's enemies across the globe while putting out a hand of false friendship to the United States and saying, we want to be your partners. It is very important for Americans to understand this because our national survival is at stake. And when we talk to Russians who really know, who've been involved in the hierarchy in Russia, who see many of these things quite clearly because they're on the ground in Moscow, This adds to our overall picture and helps us to understand the things that have been told us by defectors, the things that are happening now, the collapse of America's nuclear arsenal as the Obama administration removes funding from defense and refuses to fund a new nuclear warhead project, and we move towards a smaller Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps. As our economic problems worsen, the U.S. government is not spending more money on defense. It's taking money from defense and spending them on social programs. And this, in turn, is leading to the United States being divided between a left that wants to spend all the money and nationalize many of the businesses, and the traditional American way, which is capitalism and freedom, economic freedom. And as this collision course goes, it's very interesting. There was recently an article by a Russian general who made the statement that the Russian government must be prepared to support President Obama in making certain changes within the United States. So putting all this into context helps us to understand what we're about to hear from the Kalashnikovs in Moscow. We'll be back with our guests after these messages.
You're listening to Outside the Box with Jeff Nyquist. At 1020 AM or WIBG.com, we're the area's first choice for Christian news talk and a whole lot more. WIBG 1020 on your radio, online, or on your cellular. WIBG 1020, we're everywhere. You're listening to Outside the Box with Jeff Nyquist.
Viktor Kalashnikov is a former KGB lieutenant colonel who worked for Soviet intelligence before the fall of the Soviet Union. After leaving the KGB in 1992, he worked for the presidential administration of Boris Yeltsin. He also served as the Russian representative of a German oil company, and he began a career in journalism, which brought him into conflict with the Kremlin. He is currently working on a book about the changes that have taken place in Russia, and I want to give him a warm welcome to our program. Welcome to our program, Viktor Kalashnikov.
Thank you.
Viktor, Americans thought that with the fall of the Soviet Union, they were going to see a democracy in Russia. Why do we see dictatorship in the construction of new missiles, new weapons, and new belligerents?
First of all, let me still stress that the dissolution of the Soviet Union, let's take example of the Baltic states, the dissolution of the Soviet Union has allowed hopefully Ukraine is on its way towards democracy and more prosperity. Unfortunately, as far as Russia is concerned, there was no surprise that actually the old system, its major features, survived the breakdown of the USSR. And so quite soon we see that sort of restoration started again.
And so basically, the forces of the USSR, especially the KGB, survived the fall of communism and has basically reasserted itself.
Definitely so, quite right.
And was the KGB part of the democratic changes in Russia from the beginning?
They were just manipulate the so-called democratization, and were able to use the political developments in Russia for their own purposes.
So they were keen to manipulate the changes and to use those changes for their own purposes. What would those purposes be?
The purposes were first to find ways to become part of the new political system, just to penetrate parliaments, governments, etc., etc., and to redistribute the national wealth for their own advantages, to become millionaires, billionaires, the new emerging oligarch.
And, of course, the KGB in the Soviet Union had agent networks and secret structures in all the former Soviet republics, so these could become active as forces in a struggle to guide the democratic changes in virtually all the former Soviet republics.
Exactly, and that very point is sometimes disregarded by observers outside of Russia. Those networks you just mentioned, they were as extensive as comprising more than 1 million people in the Soviet Union. Those networks have